don't learn patience. You heard what he said. He said the best time to shop for your winter clothes is at the end of winter. But if we don't learn patience, then the problem is we done got this microwave generation.
That's it.
Nobody going to wait. We won't even get out of the car no more to go to McDonald's. Because nobody want to wait. We want the drive-through because it's easy, it's convenient. But the Lord is trying to teach us something. Sometimes if we would just wait, Lord have mercy. Carla, you could have preached that to me 10 years ago. Perhaps maybe I would have had to go through what I went through if I perhaps learn to wait.
Thank you, Lord.
And it is through waiting, yes, we learn something. Yes. You know, that's what we miss. You know, we don't want to go through the wait time, but when we rush through something, look at all we miss. That's why sometimes, and I'm not throwing off on nobody, but that's why sometimes many of us end at places back straight up to the next driveway, not hitting nothing.
Yes,
I didn't understand the process of waiting because had I just took time to listen, I would have thought that there were some key things that I needed to know about driving. So it is in ministry. There are some key things we need to know about God.
Yes, sir. Right.
And many of us don't understand we want to get saved today and be in the pulpit by tomorrow. But God is trying to teach us some stuff that will keep you where He has so ordained for you to be.
Thank you.
Don't it feel better to, when you listen, when I go into places now, I'm trying to prove that I can do the job because I know He equipped me.
Amen.
My character, yes, is in check. I'm not easily angry. But that was a process. Now to get to that process, I had to go through some hurts.
Yes.
I had experienced some letdowns. But oh boy, look where I'm at now. If we learn, thank you, y'all.
That's all right.
God knows.
God knows.
But if we just master this art, that's where I'm at. You know, certain stuff I don't have to have right now.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Thank you,
Lord.
She laughed.
Right.
We might want, but we don't have to have right now.
Yes, sir.
And do you know that's the best gift in the world? When you can wait on something.
Thank you.
And then listen, you don't have to worry about losing it because you prepared for it.
Thank you, Lord.
I'm gonna have a pen one day, but it ain't right now. But when I get there, I'm gonna have the power, the knowledge to sustain. What He has blessed me with.
Come on.
Everything that we rush in to get is not a blessing. Some of us, if we're honest with ourselves, if we would have waited on that man or that woman, we might have a little more hair than we have now. But thank God that He matures us.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, God.
Even when we made a mistake. Can we give Him another hand?
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
My goodness. I was talking about on last week.
Yes, sir.
I know it wasn't a traditional Easter message. But I was talking on last week how it was important for us to be baptized in the Spirit. And we use the children of Israel as an example. And so today I just want to just piggyback off that message just a little bit. Want to go somewhere just a little bit different. And I'm going to ask if Brother Michael would get Exodus, the 14th chapter, verse number 30 and 31. Exodus, the 14th chapter, verses 30 and 31. And if you will, just for a few minutes, if you would just stand as I read this word. We're not standing in honor of man, but in honor of the word of God. I'm going to read another passage shortly after that, just one verse. Let it read, thus the Lord saved Israel that day out of the hand of the Egyptians. And Israel saw the Egyptians die upon the sea. And Israel saw that great work which the Lord did upon the Egyptians. And the people feared the Lord and believed the Lord and his servant Moses. Now I'm just going to go to Exodus 15th chapter and read verse number 1, and you may take your seats. It says, then sang Moses and the children of Israel this song unto the Lord, and spake, saying, I will sing unto the Lord, for he hath triumphed graciously. The horse and his rider have he thrown into the sea. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. On last week, we sometimes you have to understand the revelation. How God brought the children of Israel out because of a promise he made to Abraham. And in this chapter we have right here the deliverance coming up to the Red Sea. And so that you can get clarity of the word, I have to journey back again to attempt to make sure we all on the same page and understand what the word of the Lord has for us today. The children of Israel, or the Israelites, if you will, were the descendants of Jacob. Jacob's name was later changed to Israel after wrestling with the angel in Genesis, the 32nd chapter, verses 24 through 30. Jacob's family had moved to Egypt at the invitation of Joseph, one of Jacob's sons who had become a great ruler under Pharaoh. While in the land, people of Israel multiplied into a great nation. You'll find that in Exodus, the first chapter, verses 6 through 10, says, and Joseph died, and all his brothers, and all of that generation died. But the children of Israel were still fruitful and increased abundantly, multiplied and grew exceedingly mighty, and the land was filled with them. Now there arose a king over Egypt who did not know Joseph. And he said to the people, look, the people of the children of Israel are more and mighty than we. Come, let us deal shrewdly with them, lest they multiply and inhabit in the event of war, that they also join our enemies and fight against us, and so go up out of this land. So Pharaoh was afraid that the Israelite was becoming too strong, and that they would organize themselves against the kingdom. And you need to know that your enemies are more afraid of you than you are of them. So he made the children of Israel slaves and oppressed them. Why would he do that? He did it to kill their spirit. He did it to try and stop their growth. You know, anytime you want to hurt somebody, anytime you want to stop somebody from moving forward, how many know all you got to do is kill their spirit? If you kill their spirit, you will cut off that lifeline. That situation or that potential that's in them to die.
Yes, sir.
If you can kill their spirit. Take somebody that's in an abusive relationship, whether it be man or whether it be woman. The oppressor usually try to take control of their mind.
Yeah, that's right.
Take control of their thoughts. See, if you can control somebody's thoughts, you need to control their spirit. I once read a story about a dog that was chained up. And they would open up the gate. And every time that dog got ready to run out, they would take and hit him with a 2x4. Well, through the process of time,
yes.
Guess what happened? They broke the dog's spirit. See, once your spirit is broken, you no longer have a chain on you. See, so it is with us in the body of Christ. The enemy tries to break our spirit. So what he does, he uses our failures against us. He uses what he knows about us to try to stop us from moving forward. Every time I decided I don't have to settle for a McDonald's job, and I thank God for a McDonald's job because it is a job. But every time I try to get in my mind that I can do better than this,
look out.
The enemy are coming and remind you, you know you got turned down at the last 3 jobs. Every time I say that I don't have to live in fornication.
Okay.
Every time I don't have to smoke and drink.
Yeah.
Every turn that I make to try to better myself. The enemy is good at bringing up your past.
Yes, sir.
I'm striving to be an evangelist, but you remember, sister, not so long ago, you were seeing Brother Nathan, so what? You ain't gonna break my spirit. So we need to understand that nothing that we do surprises God.
Hallelujah.
Everything that we go through, God knows. You think you disappointed God because you smoked again?
as if God is sitting on the throne counting every time you pick up a cigarette. Come on, y'all. You think you disappointed God because you relapsed and had a drink? As if God be ready to send you to hell. No, that's the enemy. They're trying to lock you in that situation.
That's right. Come on.
He's crafty. Every time you think you can do better, he come and tell you that you can't. He break your spirit. This is what Pharaoh was trying to do to the children of Israel. He oppressed them. We talked about it last week that when God brings you out, he brings you out to everything that's oppressing you, chasing you. Everything that's wrong with you on your back. Every failure on your back. But if you can just make it to the wall.
Come on.
Hallelujah. Everything that's of God will come out of the wall. In other words, your oppression might come to the wall. But it can't come out of the wall. My problem with the children of Israel, God brought them out. Even with Pharaoh trying to oppress them, God brought them out.
Yes, he did.
Led them all the way to the Red Sea.
Yeah, come on.
And in front of their eyes, opened up the Red Sea in front of them.
Yes,
they went through the Red Sea, not sliding mud, but on dry land.
Yes, sir.
Then they get across. See, this is my problem. They notice when they look back, they didn't see that oppressor following them. But they get into the wilderness 3 days.
Look out.
After the Red Sea. They get into the wilderness. See, the problem I have is not the wilderness experience. The problem that I have was they faked the funk.
Look out.
When they came through the Red Sea. Well, what you mean, Pastor? What do you mean they faked the funk? When they saw the enemy drown, they had a song.
Yeah, they did.
Yeah, they did.
You read in the 15th chapter, verse number 1, he says, and the Israelites sang the song unto God. You see what I'm saying? For his mighty deliverance. And I know some of you waiting on the subject, so you won't be waiting too long. I'll give you my subject. My subject again today is what happened to the song.
To the song. Come on.
Ask your neighbor, what happened to your song?
Come on.
They did witness them come out of evil. They did witness him bring them through the Red Sea.
Yes.
They got on the other side of the sea. They was able to look back. They were able to see everything that was hindering them drowned in the Red Sea.
Yes.
So they began to sing a song.
Come on.
Now they got to travel on because you know you can't just stay there at the Red Sea. Even though you see the enemy drown, you see everything that oppresses you drown, you just can't stay at the Red Sea. So they journey 3 days.
Look out.
You see how patient Carl said, we don't want to wait. Mm-hmm. They journey through the wilderness for 3 days. They forgot the song in 3 days. They was in captivity for 430 years. I'm trying to help
somebody.
Come on.
Come on now.
They was hindered by Pharaoh for 430 years. Somebody telling you to get out at this time. Make bricks without no straw. Bring this beer on my cats. Whipping on them. Killing their children. And God bring them out of 430 got it right, I believe. They didn't have Moses and Aaron holding up water. 430 years in captivity. He brings us out. There's nobody chasing us no more. At this point, don't tell some of y'all get mad. At this point, they don't even have anyone.
No,
sir. Uh-oh. See, somebody missed that. According to the word, he said Pharaoh and his army was what?
Drowned
in the Red Sea. So now they're across the Red Sea. They saw an enemy killed. At this point,
yes.
They don't even have an enemy, y'all. So where did this tension come from? Where did this massive confusion come from? If everything that held me back is in the wall. That was a sea. Wasn't no catching up with your horse and going back out on the other side. Once you was in there, you was in there. So if the enemy got across to the other side, where did he come from? What started this migration of backbiting? What started this migration of grumbling and complaining? So I'm just trying to remind somebody. Remember, you saw him die. There's nothing on your back no more. There's nothing chasing you no more. Where did the confusion come from? Perhaps it's the enemy in me. Perhaps some of our greatest destruction is ourselves. Perhaps our greatest demon is us. You don't have to raise your hand, but I raise my hand. I've been one of my worst enemies. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I've been one of my worst enemies. Who told you that you can't make it? Where you get that teaching from? If he left that what oppressed you in the law.
Thank you, God.
See, we just can't come in here and sit in these pews and jump and shout and leave out with the same mentality. You got to change the way you think.
That's right.
Thank you, Lord.
Perhaps I didn't get the promotion because I talked too much.
Thank you, God.
Somebody said, Lord, deliver me from me.
Lord,
perhaps I'm looking for somebody to give me something. I don't want to make the necessary adjustments to apply myself. See, they were complaining. Got all the way over here. Listen, this will puzzle me, y'all. They got all the way over there, and they were complaining about water. Y'all ain't got it. All that water he allowed me to pass through on both sides. Would you want some water? At least not in 3 days. When you saw how dangerous water could be, how you saw water just kill folks. They 3 days over complaining about water.
Yes, sir.
My problem is, what happened to the song? So in the meaning of our lives, God showed us miraculous ship of Zion. Yeah. My, some of my kids don't even know that stuff. Get on board, get on board. Father, I stretch my hand to thee. No other help I know. If thou should draw. See, them the songs that brought us over. You understand what I'm saying? At the cross. At the cross. Where I first saw the light. And the burden, hallelujah, of my heart rolled away. It was there. Amazing grace. Yes. How sweet the sound. Yes. That saved a wretch like me. Uh-huh. I once was lost. Uh-huh. But now I'm found. Uh-huh. Was blind. But what happened to the song? Yes, sir. Come on. I know that when we got to the wilderness 3 days. I know we didn't have no water, but somebody should have been able to look back and grab a song and say, if he brought me out before, surely he can bring me out again. What happened to the song? Maybe the first group didn't get it right, but maybe the second set of folks, somebody should have been able to look back and say, he brought me through enough. See, I'm not going to get here in the wilderness.
Or do my life or my struggles or what the Lord brought me
through. And am I ashamed to tell somebody because I'm worried about what people going to think about me?
Thank you.
But how many know you are the song that's going to change the world?
Thank you.
You are the song that's going to bring hope to a dying world.
Thank you, God.
When people see you on your job, and they know you ain't got it all together, but you come in there smiling.
Thank you.
Yes,
I'm making $5.10 an hour, but I thank God for the $5.10.
Come on.
You are the song that's going to change your children.
Yes.
You are the song that's going to change your neighbor.
Come on.
We are the song that's going to change the generation.
Yes.
But my question is, what happened to your song?
Yes.
What has bamboozled you that you won't even sing your own deliverance? Many of us would have to go through as much as we go through. We just learn to open up our mouth. But we open up our mouth to complain. We open up our mouth to get you together. We open up our mouth to tell you how we feel. But we won't open up our mouth to encourage our own self.
Thank you, God.
A song is just not just a melody. It's lyrics that people put together of their life, how they feel.
Yes, sir.
For the young lady to make the song, how I got older, how I got older, my soul looked back and wondered, how I got older.
Come on, you talk about.
You know where she got that song from?
Going through.
That's it.
James Cleveland High. Don't feel no ladies high.
Thank you, God.
Come too far.
Thank you, God.
From where I started from. Nobody told me that the road would be easy.
Yes, God.
But in spite of it all, He brought me this far.
Thank you, God.
Where your song?
What's your song?
Come on. Yes, sir.
In the midnight hour.
Thank you.
When your body racking with pain.
Come on.
What's your song?
What's your song?
Listen, you need to carry a pad to the bed with you. Start writing your deliverance song. By your stripes I'm healed.
Yeah.
Yeah. By your stripes I'm healed.
Yeah.
Somebody said, that ain't my song. That's my song.
Come on.
If you challenge financially, get you a song. He said, it may be the head and not the tail. May be the limb and not the bone. That ain't no song. Why ain't a song? Because you ain't heard it. It kept me from killing myself.
Thank you, Lord.
So what? It don't have the polish that you think it ought to have. When your marriage is being challenged, you don't have to just accept anything. Put the song on.
Come on.
Thank you.
Come on.
Put it on.
Instead of complaining, open up your mouth and put the song on.
Thank you, Lord.
You ain't going nowhere. That what he joined together? Let no man separate. Put the song on.
Yes, sir.
You unhappy? My joy, my strength is made perfect in my weakness.
All right.
We got enough testimonies in here to write a whole book of songs. We should never run out of what to sing.
Thank you.
You have a trouble in the shop, you heard? Do you hear? Deacon Carl says,
Wait on.
Come on.
Put a song on.
Put it on.
Yes, sir.
I'm blessed. I'm healed.
Yes.
Whatever it takes for you to get through, just get through.
Yes.
Get through.
Thank you, Jesus.
When he brought you out, you have a song.
Yeah.
When you're going through, you ought to have a song.
Yeah. Come on.
When he brought talked you out. You weren't quiet.
Come on.
They complained all while they were traveling. And all he brought us out to kill us. Oh, he brought us out. You were running your mouth all while he was bringing you out. Now we out and we won't say nothing.
Help us, Lord.
You don't believe it? See, y'all got to go back and read the word. Moses got mad. Moses got mad at the people. God got mad at Moses. Everybody made it. You don't believe it? Everybody, man, I'm having a riot.
That's it. That's it.
The people complained to Moses. Moses complained to God. God tells Moses, don't tell me nothing else. Tell me to be quiet and move forward.
Yes, sir.
There was a pain all the way out of Egypt. So when we're going through in our greater trial, why do we keep quiet? You gonna just sit there and let me just pinch you? You sit there. I'm digging your skin. I'm messing with your mind. I'm trying to make you give it all. And you're going to sit there quiet? If you're going to come, that's the time you ought to come. If you're going to say hell no, that's the time you ought to say it. You're not going to take my mind. Why don't you sit there quiet and just allow the enemy to beat us up? As I go to my seat, my prayer that God give you back your song.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, God.
Did you know once he gives you a song, can't nobody take your song away from you?
Yeah.
There's a song that said, don't take your joy from me. And many of us, we give our song up so easily because we really don't understand.
Yeah.
But if anybody can ever be without joy, anybody ever been unhappy?
Oh, yes.
And you regain your happiness? Do you want to put back in? Say, Lord, do you like being upset? See? You ain't gonna let me come in your life and then make you upset. That's the kind of we give the enemy. He just plagued our mind.
Yes, sir.
You see what I'm saying? Carl, Connie love you. She ain't just gonna let you come in the house every day and make her upset. She gonna set some ground rules. She gonna say, "You over there today. You over there today. Come back when your spirit's right."
That's it.
Am I right about it? Listen, this ain't nothing. It's a decision. I choose to be happy.
Thank you.
I choose to stay free.
Thank you.
I choose to remain delivered. Now, does that mean that my life is going to be perfect? No. But at least I got a solution how to come out of it.
Right, right.
And that solution is to keep my song. I'm going to sing till it get better.
Thank you.
I'm going to pray till it get better. I'm going to shout till it get better. Yeah. But above all, I ain't going to keep quiet.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you.
And if you got to go through, at least go through with your song. Because the song they sung, they sung it while they were crossing. They sung it until they witnessed their own deliverance. Sometimes it seems like our deliverance is way off. But tell somebody, keep on singing.
Keep singing.
Keep singing until you see the manifestation of that thing.
Thank you,
Lord. I talk about it all the time that, you know, I think I'm healed. When my medicine run out, because I think I'm healed, then I have a crash. Because I can take my blood pressure to this. So I'm sitting there like somebody's phone is like. I called my wife and said, something wrong with me. She already knows. She said, did you take your blood pressure? I said, no, Brenda. She said, go get your pants up here. She said, now you have to take three of them just to catch up. And it's not until I get my medicine back in. It's not that I want to take the pill. I want to be delivered, but it's a process. But I got to keep on singing until my deliverance manifests itself. Certainly, if he have healed me, then I won't have a crutch. But I got to be wise enough to do what I have to do until that manifestation. You understand what I'm saying? My children might not be where I want them yet. But I got to do what I got to do until they come up to where I want them at. Amen. Don't give up on yourself so easily. Don't give up on your song so easily. God has a plan for you. Somebody say, God got a plan for me. Amen. So the first relationship didn't work out. God got a plan for you. Maybe at this time, he just wants more of you. And somebody else in your life might serve as a distraction. See what I'm saying? But if we lose our song and just crying and complaining for when nobody loves me, somebody do love me. If you love you, it ought to be enough. I ain't gonna chop off these good fingers because Redonna get mad and tell me she don't love me no more. I'm hoping I can keep the fingers until she fall back in love with me. It just don't make business. And we let the enemy destroy our lives. And so my prayer is that we regain that song.
Yes, sir.
What happened to your song? If you lost it, this is a good day to get it back. Everything that you go through is not to destroy you, but it's to build you up and to bring you closer to him.
Thank you.
He wouldn't have led. Listen, if he didn't have no intentions of bringing them out of the Red Sea, he would have never led them there. And just the fact that you made it out says that he's going to deliver you. But it's that line of that waiting. That's when we get discouraged. They standing there. They hear the people coming. They hear the chariots. They hear the distraction. But they lose focus. But I'm talking to somebody today that you're ready to get your focus back. Perhaps bitterness set in and you lost your song. Perhaps some of us got impatient. But God's got something for you. And maybe you're not where you need to be, but you can admit and say, Pastor, pray with me. Come. If you hear me not saved today, what an opportunity to come and give your life to Christ. This is a good day to get your song back. How do you know the enemy, he don't want you to have no song? But this is a good day. And if you're here today, and you are in the ark of safety, I encourage you, don't worry about who around you. Come on and get your song back. See, we watch that stuff, we don't want to equate it to spiritual stuff, but what you think the movie was about? How Stella got her groove back. She was put at a bad place in her life. She thought everything was over for her. But then something happened and she remembered that I'm better than this. That's all I'm trying to tell you. You better than where you are right now. Your relationship is better than where it's at right now. I have to put in a little more work. But it's worth the fight. I'm worth the fight. And if you hear, why don't you?